All Things Data podcast. In the spirit of Daniel Kahneman, Peter Diamandis, and Google Moonshots, brings together leading data scientists, technologists, business model experts, and futurists to discuss how to utilize, harness, and deploy data science and data-driven strategies to enable digital transformation. The hosts are Dr. Manjeet Rege, Associate Professor of Data Science, and Dan Yarmala, Director of Business Development of IoT and Data Science.
You're listening to the All Things Data podcast. My name is Manjeet Rege, and I'm joined by my co-host, Dan Yarmala, and we have an interesting topic lined up today. Hi, Dan.
Hi, Manjeet. It's great to be here, and our guest today is Raj Chhabra. He's a Senior Technology Consultant with expertise in blockchain and cybersecurity. He's a graduate from Harvard Business School and has a certificate in advanced cybersecurity from Stanford and has been consulting with financial institutions for 15 years. Welcome, Raj.
Hi, Dan. Hi, Manjeet. Happy to be here.
So, Raj, let me start off by asking a question. We have a large listener base, or rather a diverse listener base, who might not be familiar with what blockchain is. We have been hearing about blockchain in the media quite a lot these days. So, what is blockchain and why is it relevant?
I'll put it simply, it's a distributed ledger. That's all anybody has to remember because there is a much broader definition of blockchain as well. But if you remember just that, that'd be enough. If you go on YouTube or anywhere, if you just say, what is blockchain, you will get a wide spectrum of definitions. Distributed ledger is primarily that where it's like a distributed database where information is not sitting at one place. The sanctity of that information is maintained using cryptography. That's what blockchain does.
Now, in terms of some of the benefits of this, so when you say that it is distributed, so which means possibly, if there are any changes in that particular ledger, everybody else can probably see it. So that brings up two issues. One is with regards to privacy. I don't want somebody else looking at my transaction. So if I'm, let's say buying a car from a dealer, I would like to know, how many hands it has changed. But at the same time, I wouldn't like to know their financial history. Or if I'm selling my car to somebody else, 2-3 owners down the line, I wouldn't like them to know everything, in terms of my financial dealings with that car. So how does that play into all of this?
So that's a very appropriate question. So it's important to understand that there are two types of blockchains. One is a public blockchain, which is open for everybody to see what is happening, and the other could be an enterprise private blockchain. The example that you gave in a car dealer situation, you are basically using an asset. You're saying the car is the asset. So the history of the car is visible to anybody who's buying the car, knowing how many hands it has exchanged, or what value it was sold for before or after. When we create a private blockchain, we could use a technology called smart contracts, which defines what can or cannot be done with it. It is dependent upon that particular creator of blockchain or company. They can say, listen, you can only see the last transaction, or you could just see the name, or you may not see the name, but you can see the value. all that is doable using smart contracts. So how it's laid out, it depends upon how that blockchain is created, how it's programmed, how the smart contract is written. So in public blockchains, yes, that could be a concern, but there are examples where the transparency is key to the transactions. Those are right use cases for blockchain. And for example, your currencies, like in a Bitcoin or in any kind of cryptocurrency, you want to know, want to make sure that what's the history of that particular asset. In some cases, you may not want that. In that case, you do not want to go the public blockchain route. You want to go private blockchain route.
If I try to draw a parallel between a smart contract and, let's say, the business rules, would you agree it's kind of similar, where a smart contract is kind of trying to set rules? And is that kind of true throughout the life of that asset?
Yes. So that's a very important question you asked. So once you've written the smart contract, a smart contract is basically saying, this is what can be done, if then. This is an if-then situation. If this happens, then that happens. Once you've written the contract and you've started the chain, you cannot alter the contract. So it's extremely important that the smart contract is written properly. It's written for use cases that in the business world, they have been tested. And there's history of what's the user behavior, what things could happen in the future. Smart contract will stay constant throughout the life of that particular blockchain.
Raj, this is Dan. You know, can you distinguish that, the smart contract versus what we have today, like letters of credit? Tell me why it's better.
So letters of credit is basically nothing but a contract, a regular contract between two parties. And then there is an intermediary. Now, what happens is that intermediary enforces the rules of the letter of credit. The issuer of the letter of credit and the two parties around it, or three parties or multiple parties around it. What blockchain does primarily is that it instills trust in a transaction using smart contracts. So the intermediary is now replaced with a smart contract, which is written in letter of credit. If there was an electronic letter of credit application, there was a meeting of minds between two parties for a transaction that required a letter of credit, the payments will be released on the delivery of the goods. Simple as that. When that happens, the payment will automatically be released if there is a verifiable, electronically verifiable record of receipt of goods. So the party in the middle doesn't have to take an action. So it removes the middleman. That's the core achievement of blockchain, is that it removes the middleman that instills trust in a relationship, in any relationship, now be it banking, be it insurance, and a lot of other examples are there.
Yeah, I mean, it's worth pointing out that letters of credit or even wire transfers globally are very cumbersome for most people. You have to go in, you have to pay $50 to do an international wire transfer, and then humans have to do it, and then it takes 3 days, which is why Western Union is such a boon for the Latin American and Mexican markets, right? So because it's fast, but, you know, there's a big chunk that takes out of it. But one thing with smart contracts, I think people have to understand also, smart contracts can get very complicated when it's enterprise level contracts, service level agreements. And this is where I get really excited at the level of depth of smart contracts being able to show, you know, when there's certain kind of people get incentives to meet their service level agreements. And this is a way for it to be immutable and agreed upon business rules. I don't know if you want to comment on that, Raj, but that's what I get most excited about.
You're absolutely right. And this is the area. Enterprise blockchain implementation is the game changer here. But you would have observed one thing if you're noticing the blockchain industry. Everybody is excited about it, but nothing really is happening on the enterprise level, on the private blockchain level. Everybody has come to, they made up their mind that we're going to adopt blockchain, and they have use cases that are appropriate for it. But you don't see, you haven't seen yet any public issuance of insurance or a letter of credit or remittances that is happening on a large scale level or enterprise level, because writing of a smart contract is it may seem simple to say, just write a smart contract, but it's extremely cumbersome. And you can debug it. You've written it, you push it, you're done. Blockchain's written. To change any blockchain, you need a consensus of every party that is already involved in the blockchain. That usually is a huge problem. So that's why people, you know, they are writing it, and then they are also involved in reinventing their business processes to simplify that, so that now it can fit the smart contract world, where you don't need an intermediary or that many intermediaries. But I'd like to come back to an earlier point that you made about Western Union. I don't know if you know, remittances runs countries. There are countries in the world that would go bankrupt if there were no remittances. This is, I think, to the tune of about $600 to $700 billion of remittances happen every year. The number of people in the food chain in remittances is huge. And the time is also, it could be a long time to send remittances. That's the first industry, I think that's the lowest hanging fruit, I would say, that's going to get disrupted or transformed altogether. Companies like Western Union should be very worried that remittances are going to become peer-to-peer. And fees is still a problem with Bitcoin price going so high. If that is the primary vehicle for transferring money, to do a Bitcoin transaction today costs up to $20. Sometimes it's $15. That's almost at par with the amount of money that it takes to transfer the funds. So that still needs to be resolved.
I think it's worth noting for people that want to understand, I mean, there's data scientists and savvy business people understand smart contracts and cryptocurrencies, and then they understand Bitcoin, and then they understand Ethereum, and they understand like Ethereum's price point is pretty good. It's smart contracts, it's not currency, and it's a platform to build smart contracts on. However, you said it's very difficult. Now, why don't you tell us why it's difficult, and like how do we hear the signal from the noise when we hear all this stuff and interpret it as to, you know, how do we play? How does somebody play that understands, or how should they be framing it in their mind?
Take a regular contract in a simple transaction. A to B, there's a contract in the middle. Contract is, say, 15 pages long. There are legal sides of it. There is a regulatory side of it. There is privacy side of it. And then there's a business rule side of it. Okay? When you translate that particular paper into an electronic if-then situation, not everything is black and white. Not everything is black and white in a contract. That's why when there's a dispute, people end up in courts and say, my interpretation is this and your interpretation is that. So because not everything is black and white, and when you have to code it, you are somehow making it black and white. And that process is complicated. That's number one. Number two, when you have a contract between two parties, it's not just that contract you have to worry about. There are underlying contracts in the society or the laws of the land that you have to also factor in. Even those have to be then built into that blockchain so that it's not ignoring those. Otherwise, you'll have legal problems. Third, in a letter of credit situation, there may be other intermediaries that you cannot ignore. Like, for example, regulator could be reporting could be a requirement. And you have to then factor that in as well. So there's several layers of it, and not everything is black and white. That's why it's complicated.
You know, Raj, I want to ask you further about how one could track the history of an asset within a blockchain. So for example, if I end up buying any asset which has been part of a blockchain system, supposedly, you know, I can look at its history. Does that also mean, you know, with smart contracts and this trust and privacy built into the system, that it is completely fraud proof? That is, if I end up buying an expensive item, like let's say diamond, I know exactly where it has come from. And would that be completely authentic, or is there a possibility of a fraud happening?
No, there's definitely a possibility of fraud, but there is a type of fraud that can happen on it, but there's other types of frauds that cannot. Now let me answer that for you. Fraud happened where somebody has changed the history and changed the information, saying this didn't happen. I was the one who purchased it, and I purchased it for a lower amount, or I purchased it for a higher amount, as against the real amount that this transaction happened on. That cannot go. That cannot happen. But you could start a fraudulent blockchain and co-opt with 50-100 people. All of them have to then be in on that fraud and then create a blockchain, create an impression that there is a history of this particular diamond. And you may then buy into that channel and then say, okay, I think 100 people are saying it's legit, then it must be legit. If the information is not changed, that means information stands as it was entered the first time. If the information was incorrect the first time, just because it hasn't been changed, that doesn't mean it's accurate.
Right.
Fraud is possible, but then you have to be mindful as to which chain you're trusting to go with, what's the level of history, what kind of people involved in that. And because it is visible to you, it's easier now for you to verify things. Right now, if you buy something, you just have to trust your jeweler and a paper, and that's it. That's what you have. Right. You will have way much more information later on.
That's great. So just to summarize our conversation so far, blockchain basically is a distributed ledger system, and you have a particular user, you know, in the marketplace making a purchase, he or she can then verify all of the history, all of the transactions that particular asset has gone through. Now, moving on, I would like to talk about Bitcoin here. Bitcoin is an application of blockchain. Can you talk about how Bitcoin is related to blockchain and what exactly happens? I mean, why is it so popular again these days?
Bitcoin is one application of blockchain. Is the most popular application of blockchain. And Bitcoin gives credibility to blockchain, actually, to a very large extent, that people can rely on it, that multiple people could understand this, could transact with it, that they are not averse to an electronic means of transaction. Now, what does blockchain primarily do? It takes an asset and it makes it electronic. That's what it does. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, what's the most common asset that touches every individual on the face of Earth? Money.
Mm-hmm.
Currency touches everybody. And it's also most fluid. Mm-hmm. You transact with dollars every day. you may not transact with your car or any asset for that matter every day. So what Bitcoin basically did was it's the open blockchain implementation. That means it's visible to everybody, the history. So right now, if Dan spent $100 a year ago on Christmas Eve, if I asked Dan, I said, where's that $100 bill now? You would have no clue after 5 minutes of it. But now all the history of each Bitcoin or the fraction of it is connected to that particular transaction. I can go on and on, but it's basically Bitcoin is one implementation of blockchain, and it does extremely well, extremely fluid. It's actually very efficient, but has its own limitations. And I think a lot of people talk about what Bitcoin limitations are, but we could talk about that.
So in terms of the value of a Bitcoin, it has been going up and down. Just a few months ago, it had reached 20,000. As we speak right now, it is somewhere around 9,000. What is causing that such a volatile valuation of a Bitcoin?
For that definition or explanation, I'll step back a little bit. Your dollar bill in your hand doesn't have any intrinsic value, does it? Can you, if the U.S. government tomorrow says this dollar bill is worth zero, we are not going to stand behind it. Mm-hmm. That's just a piece of paper. What happens is the only reason it has value, it's that there is a trusting party in the middle, a government, who says if people, there was a time there was gold connected to it, the gold standard, and then it was removed. Paper is backed by U.S. government. But the price of dollar goes up and down with demand and supply of dollar in the world. Mm-hmm. The only thing that's different in Bitcoin is there is demand and supply of Bitcoin in the world, except there is no regulator. There is nobody in the middle that says this is how much the price of Bitcoin should be, or we want to maintain it within this range. Every government in the world regulates their currency. They take economic decisions based on the price of their currency. Like in Canada right now, yesterday, due to in a one statement by Donald Trump, Canadian dollar shot up because tariffs are not going to get applied in Canada and Mexico. Now, that's an external event that affected the demand and supply of currency. Similarly, in Bitcoin, because there is no regulator, it's more volatile right now. But also a lot of new entrants coming. People are investing in Bitcoin. They're not really transacting in Bitcoin, which is a problem right now. Mm-hmm. But I personally believe that it will bear out. It will even out with time. And what will happen is once people start to transact in it, the demand will gradually go up. And then the volatility will be less and less. But you will see this period of volatility for quite some time. And then it could be scary volatility.
Now, there are a few alternatives to Bitcoin, such as Litecoin, Zcash, Dash. Are these all implementations of blockchain? And then what are the differences between them as well?
The difference is the same as you have many currencies in the world. You have Bangladeshi taka or Japanese yen, different audience, different number of people trust it. They're all blockchain implementations, more or less. Some can argue, no, not really blockchain in IOTA cases and in Ripple's cases. But they're all blockchain implementations primarily. They are distributed. They have their value. And also their number of coins that are floated in the market. Because in Bitcoin, there's a limit of how many Bitcoins can ever land in the marketplace. It's 21 million. You cannot have more than 21 million Bitcoins in the world ever. You cannot have more than that unless it's changed, unless it's forked. And then now you have Bitcoin Cash that has a different level. So when a currency is created and floated, the creator of the currency says, this is how many currency tokens you can have in the marketplace. Mm-hmm. And that determines the demand supply.